So the AFCF 2016 project not only includes the projects that we'll be discussing today, there are many other portions. The 2016 final general reevaluation report, EIS EIR, was authorized in WERDA, the Water Resources Development Act of 2016. And the construction which provided funding for this project was passed in 2018 with the bipartisan budget. Next slide. I wanted to present to you the greater study project purpose that began in 2016 and is still the purpose of this project today. Generally, the purpose is to address the seepage, slope stability, erosion, and height concerns on the levees along the Sacramento and American rivers to improve flood risk management in the Sacramento metropolitan area. Sacramento is located within a natural floodplain due to the confluence of the American and Sacramento rivers, and is actually one of the most at-risk cities in the entire nation for catastrophic flooding. As you can see in this photo of the river, this occurred in 1986. It was a pretty serious erosional event in the River Park neighborhood, which is just adjacent to the I-80 bridge, and it nearly became a catastrophic flood. There is an unacceptably high risk of flooding from levee failure that threatens the public safety of over 500,000 people and nearly 100,000 structures, including homes. The hydraulic modeling completed for the 2016 study, which you can see in these figures on the right and left, demonstrated that flooding could reach a depth of over 20 feet in some areas and cause up to $4 billion in damages, which is an enormous economic disaster that would impact the local, state, and federal economy. So that dollar amount is actually in 2016 value, so that does not consider inflation to today in 2024. Now, since the 2016 study, the Folsom Joint Federal Project, JFP, was completed, which increased the maximum outflow of Folsom Lake to 160,000 cubic feet per second. The current and ongoing Folsom Dam Raise project is increasing storage capacity, and that combined with increased flow requires levee and infrastructure improvements throughout the downstream levee network. Increased spills from Folsom lead to higher water surface elevations in the river channel, higher velocities due to the constricted levee system, and substantially increases the risk of levee erosion that could ultimately lead to levee failure. Levee failure has the potential to lead to immediate loss of life and injury to people in neighboring communities, as well as health and public safety concerns associated with flood damages, including lack of electricity, clean water, or access to emergency care. Next slide. After the ARCF 2016 project was authorized by Congress, USACE began the detailed design. River surveys were completed by boat with visual inspections of each river reach. Reaches were ranked by current status and included levels of existing erosion. Geotechnical and soil sampling was conducted. Following that visual ranking, afterwards, reaches were grouped into projects, and projects were then prioritized based on their constructability and sequence to provide flood risk reduction benefits to communities with the highest life safety risk and most costly flood-related damages. As you can see, there are several projects that have already been completed. Some of these include the Sacramento River East Levee SREL Seepage Stability Overtopping Project. We have the Sacramento Weir and Bypass Widening Project, which is under construction now. And please note that all of the prior environmental documentation for already constructed contracts is available on the website sacleveeupgrades.com, which will be provided later. Next slide. So the need for this supplemental environmental impact statement, subsequent environmental impact report, we'll refer to it as the SEIS, SEIR, is needed to analyze the design refinements that have occurred since the 2016 GRR EIS EIR was finalized. In the past 8 years, there have been design refinements to the following project components, including American River Erosion Contract 3B, 4A, and 4B, Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3, the Magpie Creek Project, American River and Sacramento River mitigation sites, and a piezometer network. Some of these design refinements include changes to the scope, location, design, or construction details, These refinements resulted due to new engineering data, such as the geotechnical investigations, hydraulic modeling, improved technology and research, updates in federal, local, and state, and even levee safety policy, and environmental compliance regulations. For example, new executive orders that have been passed regarding climate change, greenhouse gases, and environmental justice. We expect that the record of decision and the CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act certification, will occur late summer or fall of this year. Next slide. I want to direct your attention to the map so that you can identify all of the separate project components. They are all within Sacramento County. We will start on the American River. As you can see towards the east, American River erosion contracts 3B North and 3B South, they're in pink and orange. Also, American River erosion contract 4B is in blue. If you go downstream, there is a yellow polygon that is American River erosion contract 4A. And even further downstream towards the confluence of the Sacramento River is the American River mitigation site in red. If we go north, just north of Sacramento, you will see a brown line. That's the Magpie Creek project. If we go back to the Sacramento River and we go south into the pocket neighborhoods, we will find Sacramento River erosion contract 3, those two green lines along the levees. Further south and in that separate box is the Sacramento River mitigation site, and that's the little purple triangle, and it's along along the Sacramento River and down towards the Delta. So the intent of this report that we're presenting today is to present you the proposed project with alternatives, describe the alternative selection process, to demonstrate the analyzation of the short and long-term impacts associated with the project, including human, physical, ecological, and biological, and cultural resources. Additionally, we will describe if significant impacts arose, and in the document, we propose mitigation measures that can be implemented prior, during, or after construction. Next slide. So I want to briefly go over these design refinements by project component, and they will be discussed in detail just after I'm done. So I'll start with American River. There's a variety of contracts, and the reason that we included these in this document, this SEIS, SEIR, is because we have refined the erosion protection methods to include a launchable tow protection. This erosion protection method is used to provide better on-site mitigation, fisheries habitat, and actually decreases the impacts to the heritage oak trees. It also, we've refined the haul routes and staging areas. We've added a contract due to new hydraulic modeling to better protect the State Route 160 bridge from severe erosion due to high velocity in the river channel. And these refined designs also require more rock and soil materials. Additionally, the contract on the Sacramento River, similarly, we have refined the erosion protection methods for the launchable tow protection to provide better on-site mitigation. There's been new identification of landside staging areas. Additionally, the 2016 document originally assumed that work would be completed in the river by barge. Now we will be operating with construction equipment on the river shoreline. Similar to the American River, these refined designs require more soil and rock material. Next slide. The Magpie Creek project to the north of Sacramento includes the levee extension, widening, and realignment of a portion of the Magpie Creek diversion channel. Additionally, this project will include culverts beneath the Sacramento River bike trails, new flowage easements to allow for water retention upstream of Rayleigh Boulevard. There will be night work and a full road closure at Rayleigh Boulevard for a portion of construction. The piezometer network was not described in the 2016 EIS EIR, and this includes a groundwater data collection system that will be implemented after construction to monitor the levee improvement performance. The mitigation sites have been further designed than were presented in the 2016 documents. The American River mitigation site is about 120 acres. It'll be newly constructed, and that exists in the American River Parkway. There are the species and habitats here that we will get into detail further in the slides. The Sacramento River mitigation site will be also about a newly constructed mitigation site, about 200 acres. It's located at Grand Island on the Sacramento River near the confluence of the Cache and Steamboat sloughs. The listed species and habitats that we will be constructing to provide habitat for are listed here. Like I said, we'll get into the details further on. Now I'll let my colleague, Ms. Bailey Hunter, discuss the details of the American River Erosion Contracts 3B, 4B, and 4A, Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3, and the Magpie Creek Project. She'll be starting off with American River Erosion Contract 3B, which has one of the highest risks of levee failure and risk to life safety in the region, and is a number one priority for USA Sacramento District.
Hello, my name is Bailey Hunter. I work for the Army Corps. I'm going to go over some of the projects and the environmental impacts that our team found when we did our analysis. I'm going to start on the American River with American River Erosion Contract 3B. This is an erosion project. It's technically actually made up of two contracts, 3B North and South. 3B North is made up of Site 31. Which is in between Howe Avenue and Watt Avenue on the north side of the river, and Site 42, which is between Watt Avenue and kind of the Rio Americano school area. 3B South is made up of from just down the stream of Watt Avenue to the drain. 3B is made up of a bunch of types of erosion protection measures that we picked site by site in very specific locations to try and minimize the environmental impacts as much as possible. We have levee and riverbank bank protection, which is placing soil-filled rock over the ground, placing a little bit of soil on top so we can plant. We have buried launchable trench, which is essentially buried revetment. So as the riverbank erodes away, eventually it'll hit that buried revetment, which will launch and stop further. It's buried, so we can plant on top of it. We got launchable tows, which is putting kind of a back of revetment in the river, which allows us to have planting benches behind it. And as the riverbank erodes, it'll launch and stop further erosion. Right next to contract 3B is contract 4B. And basically, when the design team was doing their analysis, they determined that there were some trees right next to 3B that are at risk of what we're calling lone tree scour, which essentially is trees kind of by themselves that are pretty big, and at certain velocities, the eddies kind of the water kind of go around the tree and erode away around the base of the tree, which puts the levee at risk. So 4B is looking at different measures like placing gravel or placing revetment, or in some cases, having to cut down the tree to prevent that erosion from occurring. And this, the work is one location is on the north side of the river, just downstream of Watt, and one location is on the south side of the river, just downstream of Larchmont Park. Next slide, please. The environmental impacts that we found are listed below. A big one is recreation. All the projects in the American River Parkway, we will be disrupting during construction and staging, which is going to impact people wanting to recreate. For transportation and circulation, we're going to be adding a lot of haul trucks to local roads. For environmental justice, those haul trucks are going to pass through disadvantaged communities. For aesthetics and visual impacts, the vegetation we have to remove to install the erosion features will decrease the visual character of the area until we're able to get plants and trees to reestablish. For water quality, we found that some trees that might be removed near the water's edge could increase the water temperature until vegetation reestablishes. For air quality and climate change, it was determined there's high NOx and greenhouse gas emissions from the haul trucks and construction equipment. For noise and vibration, the levees are pretty close to homes, so high noise levels from construction could disrupt sensitive receptors. And by sensitive receptors, we mean people living in their homes or people recreating and wanting to enjoy the kind of pristine area, that kind of stuff. For vegetation, wildlife, fisheries, and special status species, we have to do habitat removal and disturbance in order to install our erosion protection features, So as I mentioned, we are going to be replanting. Slide, please. The other erosion project on the American River is American River Erosion Contract 4A. It is on the north side of the river, just upstream of State Route 160. This map makes it look like it's a really big project, but actually the erosion features is just a small berm just next to the bridge. The problem is, and that berm is a velocity diversion berm. So the risk at this site is erosion from velocities, but also a major risk is erosion from pier scour. So similar to what I was saying about Lone Tree scour, the eddies at certain velocities kind of go around the pier and scour away, risking putting the levee at risk for failure. So we are proposing to build a berm that would deflect those velocities away. Problem is, the location where that berm needs to be is on top of the Jedediah Smith Memorial Trail. So we're having to do a permanent reroute of the memorial trail in order to install this work. So a lot of that stuff you're seeing on the map is actually the reroute to allow recreation to continue. Next slide, please. So as I mentioned, a big recreational impact is that the erosion features are going to block the memorial trail, and we're having to do a reroute in the floodplain. But additionally, we are still in the American River Parkway, so we are going to be disrupting during construction. For transportation and circulation, similar to Contract 3B and 4B, we are adding haul trucks to local roads. For air quality and climate change, we found high NOx and greenhouse gas emissions associated with haul trucks and construction equipment. For noise and vibration, this is a high recreational area, so the noise could disturb recreationalists. Vegetation, wildlife, and special status species, we are having to do habitat removal in order to install the erosion features and a little bit in order to install the bike trail reroute. Unfortunately, because of the location of the diversion berm, it is in the veg-free zone, so we can't replant the site with woody vegetation. So we would be planting grasses and maybe some forbs. And in addition, we are kind of adjusting the topography for that bike trail reroute, which there's a possibility we could risk increasing fish stranding at the site. Next slide, please. For 4A, we looked at a few different alternatives. So the very first map you're seeing is the proposed alternative. The second map, alternative 3A, would be a landside berm. It would have similar impact to the proposed action, except for there'd be less vegetation, wildlife, fish, special species, habitat impacts, less recreational impacts, less resource impacts, and no impact to risk of fish stranding. Alternative 3B would be a similar bike trail reroute, except for instead of going under the railroad and connecting further down, we would shoot up parallel to the railroad and connect back to the bike trail just past the berm. That is similar to the proposed action, except there'd be slightly lower impact to the overall habitat, but slightly higher impact to special species habitat. Alternative 3C would be instead of going into the floodplain for a bike trail detour, we would have the bikes go around the berm. However, we'd still need a temporary detour for folks to get around during construction, so we would still have to impact those areas. It would have a similar impact to the proposed action, except for higher impact on veg, wildlife, fish, and special status species, so there'd be a lower impact to the risk of fish stranding. Alternative 3D would have a longer bike trail detour or reroute, which would go further down into the floodplain and be similar to the proposed action, except for it'd have a higher impact on veg, wildlife, and special status species. Next slide, please. Now we're moving on to the Sacramento River. So this is the only erosion project on the Sacramento River in this environmental document, Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3. It is along parts of the pocket neighborhood. So you see in the first map, that's on the northern part, and the other map is on the southern part. 3B is a mixture of kind of revetment being placed at grade and launchable toe, which I kind of talked about with 3B as well, and then some tiebacks. You'll notice in these maps, there's a lot less access, and that is because the materials for construction are being brought in by barges instead of haul trucks. So there are some aesthetic and visual impacts due to vegetation removal, which would decrease the visual character along the area. For water quality, removal of trees along the riverbank could increase the water temperature. For air quality and climate change, we found high NOx and greenhouse gas emissions associated with barges and construction equipment. For noise and vibration, we are near neighborhoods, so there would be high noise levels that could disrupt sensitive receptors. For vegetation, fish, wildlife, and special status species, habitat removal and disturbance is required for installation of the erosion protection features. Next slide, please. And then we have Magpie Creek Project, which is along the Magpie Creek Diversion Channel. If you're unfamiliar, it's kind of north of Sacramento, kind of near Rio Linda. If you're familiar with the jet or the water ski school, you can see those big ponds just north of the project. You'll also see Rayleigh Boulevard on the right. So this project is a mixture. So the other projects we talked about were erosion. This project is seepage instability. It's a mixture of widening the channel, modifying the channel, extending the levee, and installing some culverts under Rayleigh Boulevard and the bike trail. Next slide, please. So the environmental impacts, we are constructing, as I mentioned, some culverts under the Sacramento Northern Bike Trail. So we're gonna require some detours for transportation and circulation. Rayleigh Boulevard would be closed for work and it's gonna require some traffic detours. In addition, haul trucks will be added to local roads. Environmental justice, those haul trucks would be going through some disadvantaged communities. For water quality, construction could cause short-term water quality issues once water is reintroduced to the new and wider channel. So basically, we're gonna go in and kind of dig out the channel, make it wider, but we're gonna be stirring stuff up. So once we reintroduce water back into that channel, all that stuff we've kind of stirred up is gonna be pushed out. So it'd only be a water quality impact right when we reintroduce water back in. For air quality and climate change, we saw high NOx and greenhouse gas emissions associated with haul trucks and construction equipment. For noise and vibration, there are some homes in the area, so there'd be high noises that could disrupt sensitive receptors. For hydraulics and wetlands, there are impacts to wetlands east of Rayleigh Boulevard. And in addition, it was found that there's a downstream stage increase just upstream of the Northern Bike Trail on Rubble Creek due to increased Magpie Creek Diversion Channel capacity during high events larger than 7% AEP.
Hi everyone, I'm Nikki Schleter, and I'm going to switch gears slightly and move away from the bank improvements to mitigation. As we all know, the Supplemental Environmental Impact Statement is the umbrella document to show compliance with all environmental laws. Some of those laws require mitigation, which can take many forms, but I'm going to focus on species and habitat mitigation. The site design teams start with the entire study area, identifying the need, which Kelly so clearly laid out at the beginning, the risk, and then we narrow in on locations that need the work. Then as they design the repair work, the overall footprint shrinks in size. These steps are known as avoiding and minimizing necessary impacts. Then the unavoidable impact, first on site as much as possible and then off site. Repair works is designed to incorporate native vegetation to the maximum extent possible, which can look like buried rock trenches, soil-filled riprap, laying back banks for a softer slope, and including bioengineering. All of these methods allow vegetation to grow back on site. Once construction is finished and the vegetation is planted, it will be irrigated and maintained for a few years to ensure that it will continue to grow and recreate the habitat that has been disturbed. The photograph on the right shows an example of older repair sites done on the Lower American River. It started in May of 2001 with some basic plantings and rock revetment at the bottom of the levee slope. And then over time, you can see how the vegetation grew back in, creating the riparian corridor that we're familiar with today over by Guy West. Next slide. Now, unfortunately, not all of our habitat mitigation can be completed within the repair footprint, which requires the project partners to go outside of the construction footprint and identify locations suitable for replacing the lost habitat and functions and services. This next site is on the Sacramento River. It's the Sacramento River Mitigation Site, or SRMS for short. The site is strategically located at the confluence of Cache Creek Slough, the Sacramento River, and Steamboat Slough, right on the migratory corridor for all of our listeners. Currently, the land is upland habitat, but after the mitigation project will be completed, it's going to provide habitat and a food source for Chinook salmon, Delta smelt, and green sturgeon by reconnecting the floodplain habitat to the river. Then appropriate native vegetation will be planted around the higher elevation to ensure their stopover habitat for a migratory bird. Next slide. The environmental impacts are all resulting from the construction and creating the new habitat, such as water quality turbidity when we're connecting the river to this constructed site, greenhouse gas emissions associated with equipment, moving the material around on site, and carving out our channels. And there'll also be some visual impact to the folks driving along Highway 160. You can see the Grand Island site from across the river. Next slide. Multiple alternatives were considered to this mitigation site and eliminated before the document took shape. The alternatives that remain are the purchase of mitigation credits for all mitigation requirements for all species. The next is purchasing a different plot of land and constructing connected floodplain habitat elsewhere on the Sacramento River and doing a combined bank credit purchase for anything that we're not able to construct. Lastly is a combination project focusing on one of National Marine Fisheries Service recovery projects combined with purchasing mitigation credits. Each of these has their own pros and cons, and they're discussed further in the document. And here we're showing the American River Mitigation Site, or ARMS. The site is located next to Discovery Park on the north bank of the Lower American River. Currently, the area consists of man-made ponds surrounded by managed uplands with a fringe of riparian habitat. After the mitigation project, it will be a connected floodplain that is inundated year-round at different water elevations, providing rearing habitat and food sources for Chinook salmon and steelhead. The newly adjusted elevations will be planted with appropriate native vegetation, which will allow stopover habitat for migratory birds, a corridor for all of the wildlife that currently exists in the Lower American River, and will create some elderberry savanna habitat around the highest elevation, targeting mitigation for all of our endangered species. Next slide. So there's quite a few environmental impacts associated with this one. Very similar to the Sac River Mitigation Site, the greenhouse gas emissions and noise from equipment moving dirt. There'll be some water quality impact when we connect the channels to the river. And there'll also be temporary impacts to the visual aesthetics and recreation. We will have some trail impacts. Folks using the parkway for recreation and using the river for recreation will be able to see the construction occurring. Lastly, this site is well known for its cultural significance to local tribes. Next, I'm going to hand it over to Mr. Josh Brown, and he's going to talk about our alternatives.
Good evening. My name is Josh Brown. I'm with the California Department of Water Resources Division of Flood Management, Flood Projects Branch. During scoping, written comment was received from Sacramento County Department of Regional Parks. Regional Parks requested that an alternative for the American River Mitigation Site that retained a portion of the existing pond be considered. Regional Parks provided a specific conceptual design in their comment letter. The alternative design proposed by Regional Parks was included and analyzed as alternative 4A in SEIR and is shown in the upper left side of this slide. Although Regional Parks identified the alternative as requiring little or no soil import, subsequent investigations of the ARMS site indicated that much of the soil material on site is unsuitable for reuse, So the assumption for soil import and export were adjusted in the SEIR Alternative 4A. Based on this newer information, Alternative 4A would modestly reduce the soil handling that would be required as part of the proposed action, reducing transportation, air quality, greenhouse gas impacts, but still not avoiding significant impacts in these topic areas. Additionally, several sensitive resources and habitats located on the site, including an eagle's nest, were not well known at the time that regional parks proposed the conceptual design that became Alternative 4A. After further analysis, it was determined that the proposed design would directly impact the eagle's nest that is located on the site. To avoid impacts on these sensitive resources under Alternative 4A, while still analyzing an alternative that would retain a portion of the pond, DWR and the Central Valley Flood Protection Board included Alternative 4B in the SEIR. Alternative 4B, illustrated on the right side of the slide, was developed during the USACE design process to retain a portion of the pond, reduce potential impacts from disturbance on the nesting eagle, and create the largest area possible of restored habitat, particularly for sensitive fish species in the remaining area. Like Alternative 4A, Alternative 4B would reduce the transportation, air quality, greenhouse gas emission impacts compared to the proposed action, but would not avoid significant impacts. American River Mitigation Sites 4A and 4B were considered under CEQA only in this analysis. Alternatives 4A and 4B were rejected from further consideration under NEPA, as it was determined that these alternatives would result in the site not meeting concurrent mitigation requirements for specific habitat types, would increase the number of additional mitigation sites needed, result in additional land acquisitions, and result in overall substantial increased costs to fulfill the mitigation requirements. Both alternatives 4A and 4B would retain a substantial portion of the Arms Pond, approximately 20 or 30 acres. However, under these alternatives, the habitat mitigation requirements to address the impacts of the overall project could not be accommodated on the Arms site. If alternatives 4A or 4B were implemented, additional habitat mitigation would need to be constructed elsewhere on the lower American River, where opportunities are extremely limited, or mitigation credits purchased, which may not be readily available.
The last project component discussed in this SEIS-SEIR is the piezometer network. A piezometer is a tool that measures underground water pressure, and we use it to monitor groundwater levels and flow patterns. So this network will be installed after the construction of each project component, and it will be located within the 2016 authorized project footprint, as you can see outlined in this figure. The purpose is to collect data to evaluate the long-term performance of the levee improvements and the flood risk reduction measures. The image of this piezometer is shown on your right to give you an idea of the scale. This actually was taken on a Sacramento River East Levee, or SREL, and was installed by USACE. Now, we will be, they'll be a little bit different because they will have a solar panel so that the data can be collected and sent remotely to the district. So there will be minor environmental impacts associated with the installation of these. It does require a drill rig to install down to drill down to the groundwater level. So there will be noise and visual and some recreational impacts associated with the installation. And that would be a temporary and minor disruption to maybe people on the bike trail. There would not be full closures, but it may be loud in the area for a day or two. Mitigation measures would be implemented to ensure that there is no groundwater contamination. So now that we have wrapped up all of the different project components, I did want to discuss cultural resources briefly. Our cultural resources specialist put together this slide, but could not make it to this presentation today. However, I did want to discuss that USACE has identified potential impacts related to cultural, historic, archaeological, and tribal resources resulting from the project. This process involves completion of a programmatic agreement with the California Historic Preservation, or State Historic Preservation Officer, or the SHPO. Each phase of ARCF has a uniquely developed process to protect these resources. Resources have been identified through research, site surveys, ground testing, and consultation with the public and Native American tribes. Additionally, we welcome any information from the public regarding via local knowledge or identification of cultural resources. So I wanted to discuss the milestone schedule for this document. Going back, we started this process in about October of 2022. We opened up for scoping, for public scoping in November of 2022. I wanted to note that comments received during the scoping period are included in an appendix in this SEIS SEIR and have responses from both USACE and the project partners. So those are available to review anytime. We released this draft SEIS SEIR in just last month, December. The public comment period is open now and ends February 5th. I have outlined just the basic milestones as we expect them to come for finalizing this document. We expect that the Federal Register notification will go out in either August or September of this year with the record of decision being signed and CEQA certification occurring in the fall. Briefly, and will be followed by the Delta Stewardship Council consistency determination. Next slide. So we have outlined the general construction schedule as we anticipate it now. Of course, this is subject to change based on comments received, our contracting process, how the weather goes, all that kind of stuff. But this is as best as we can predict at the time. Oh, I won't go through too many details, but MCP is the Magpie Creek project scheduled to just be a single season construction window in 2027. American River Erosion Contract 3B is scheduled to start summer of 2024 and complete in the winter of 2026. American River Erosion Contract 4A is a two season window in the summer of 2026 and the winter of 2027. American River Erosion Contract 4B is in the very early designs, and we are not sure when that will happen quite yet. Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3 will begin summer 2025, and it'll be just a single season in that year. The mitigation site for the American River will begin in the summer 2025, likely through the end of 2027. SRMS, or Sacramento River Mitigation Site, is expected to start summer 2025 as well, and only last two seasons until the winter of 2026. Our piezometer network installation will occur as each project component is completed, and so we expect that to go through all the way until the end of 2029. I did want to note that generally our construction, you know, we begin mobilizing in the spring of the year, but we have to wait until the rain stops to really get going. So generally the construction starts in the summer and it wraps up by the time that the winter rains come. So that is all for the SEIS SEIR. Here is that SACLIVI upgrades website. And likely you already found it because you're here and you found, you know, the WebEx links and everything. I wanted to point out these red arrows that you can subscribe for construction updates. You can get on our email list. So once construction begins, you'll have all that information available to you. There's also a work inquiry and a concern submission form. So this is someplace you can go. You can submit something here and we will look into it. And finally, I have provided the email addresses so that you can submit formal comments. I've also provided our mailing addresses for both the Army Corps of Engineers and the Department of Water Resources. We have received comments already, so we are getting them. We appreciate all of them. And we do value your input. We are providing now at the end of this presentation, a 2-minute time slot for each participant so that you can have any clarifications needed. But we do request that you provide written comments so that they can be fully considered in the final SEIS SEIR. Thank you so much for attending.
So we have those email addresses handy. We also have mailing addresses if someone does want to send something through the mail. We're going to get started with the live portion of this meeting. Gonna go ahead and turn my camera on. I am glad that we have the chat back. Thank you, Paul, for working on that in the background.
Yeah, again, apologies, everybody. We were scrambling.
But they are coming in quickly. So we've got a lot of people in the background tonight. I'm just gonna be the face of the presentation again, like last week. We have so many people, probably, I don't even know, 40 or so. People with Army Corps of Engineers, DWR, Department of Water Resources. We probably have people from the board and SAFCA that are listening on this presentation and seeing all these comments as they come in. So I just want to thank you again for joining. This is the second public meeting for the American River Common Features SEIS, SEIR. I wanted to update you that with changes that have happened since that public meeting, we have posted the slides. So those are available on sacleveyupgrades.com. And then we've also posted that presentation from last week with a live recording. And that can be found under the public engagement section of SacLevy Upgrades. Once again, Paul is recording this presentation, so we'll be capturing all of this verbal participation from the public. I did want to note that, yeah, we have received several comments about quality of the figures in this presentation. We encourage you to download the documents to your computer. There is a table of contents that is linked, so you can just click on a figure if you're looking for American River Mitigation Site figure. Click on it, takes you right to the page. You can blow it up on your screen, much better. I agree, I need some new glasses myself. So that's what I'm gonna be doing. We have been receiving a lot of your comments via email. Everything in the chat will also be recorded tonight. When we receive an email, we are sending out an automatic response so that you know it was received. Some of the comments have been quite technical in nature. As I can see, they're already starting, which is great. I did want to note that we have been getting a lot of comments regarding the extension of the public comment period. That decision is elevated to leadership at this time, and we are hoping to have a decision next week. That decision will be posted on SacLevy Upgrades, and as required under NEPA and CEQA regulations, a public notice will occur if the extension is granted. We've also received, and I can see them in the chat tonight, comments regarding an in-person public meeting. That was quite a surprise for us. We've been offering virtual public meetings since the pandemic. And we've actually had such great success. We've had so many more people able to join. I'm glad to hear that that is an option that you are interested in, and we are considering that for future public outreach. I wanted to tell you the plan for tonight. Similar to Wednesday, we are all going to be here listening. But we are not responding to these verbal comments tonight. Let's see. So that, you know, the decision for that is we don't have a lot of time. I'm already feeling pressured, right? It's 6:30. We want to hear everyone. We're already running behind. So we want everyone to be able to speak. We are already in the process of comment response, however. Everything that we've received so far, it's already being categorized, it's being logged, it's being tracked, and it's being assigned to a subject matter expert, whoever that may be. This ensures that we have a clear, unified response from the Army Corps of Engineers, DWR, the board, and SAFCA. All the project proponents need to have a say. It can't just come out of my mouth, okay? I wish that I could. And then each of those responses goes through a very thorough and multiple cycles of quality control and review. That being said, we acknowledge tonight, we acknowledge all the other comments that there may be substantive comments that we receive that will require changes or additions to this draft document. Any of those changes will be incorporated into the final SEIS, SEIR. A noticing will go out for that when that happens. And there will be a very large appendix, hundreds of pages, with every comment that we've received, with a response, and all the public will be noticed when that final is released. Any changes that resulted from comments will be included in that appendix as well. So as for the public participation portion of this evening, each participant will be offered 2 minutes. You will use the raise hand icon at the bottom. I will send you a request to unmute, and I will go in the order of that I see on my screen. It might look a little different to you, but do not worry. We will get to you. We got to everyone last week. I do want to ask that if you attended last week, if you could hold your comments until the very end, we'd like to hear from any new people that joined. We do have more people here tonight than we did last week. And if you could try to reduce kind of redundant comments in the chat, we'd like to see, you know, all those new comments. I know some of this is, you know, you want to talk to other people in the chat who are on the meeting, and I understand that. It does help us in consolidating comments and responding to you better if we can reduce some of those redundancies. So that all being said, I would like to begin. So if you would like to participate, please raise your hand and we will get started. I see some of you are back again. Okay, we're gonna start with Pete Spaulding. I'm gonna send you a request to unmute.
Okay, thanks, Kaylee. And we appreciate your efforts and sure hope you're getting comp time for sticking around and running these meetings. I know you just said the requests for an in-person meeting are coming in loud and clear. I think that should be a joint meeting from you guys, SAFCA, DWR, and the Central Valley Flood Control Protection Board. You guys all have a stake in this, and you all are responsible for flood control and erosion control. So I hope your leadership listens. The maps and diagrams, like you said, I've downloaded them to my computer. I blow them up. You still can't see the detail that you need in order to comment properly on this project. And this is a repeat from what I said last week. Right now we have flood protection from a flow of 160,000 cubic feet per second. When this project is done, we're going to have protection for 160,000 cubic feet per second. If this project is not done, we're still going to have protection from 160,000 cubic feet per second. So we're not getting an extra ounce of protection. Instead, we're losing a lot of the riparian vegetation that is providing erosion protection like it has for all these years. And this is not an emergency contract. Let's take a breath, you know, listen to everybody that's making comments, give people the extra time to comment, give you guys extra time to respond to those comments, and do that and come up with an alternative design that can provide protection without devastation. If this project continues as planned, especially for 3B, all I can say is the blood of the American River Parkway is gonna be on your hands forever. My name is Pete Spaulding. I'm the volunteer steward for the American River Parkway, mile 11S. I live on Rio Bravo Circle and I've been here since July of 94. Thanks for listening.
Thanks, Pete. I think we will try to take a deeper dive into those figures. Maybe we can produce a separate appendix that we can get up on the website. I hear everything else that you're saying, but I did want to make a note of those figures. Don't worry, I am taking notes. I do better. My brain works better when I write. I'm writing everyone's names. I'm writing things that stand out to me. But do not worry, we have a lot of people taking notes in the background, and we have we will be transcribing all this as well. All right, Daniel Irola. Irola.
Hi there. I did speak last time, so I'm going to be very brief and just touch on a couple of issues that I didn't mention last time. First of all, I think that not just an in-person meeting, but a field meeting would be valuable. We really need to understand and have communication back and forth as to what this project is really going to look like. There's existing protection out there within these reaches that has been put in place that actually looks very good to me. I don't know whether what you're going to produce is similar to or different from that, but I can't get an answer because, you know, we can't have a discussion about it. I find that very frustrating. Another point that I want to make is there's no alternatives in terms of the types of erosion control measures that are being prescribed. It's kind of, you know, either we don't do it or we do it. And I think we really, considering the value of the resources here, we really need to look more at the design, different designs and what level of flood protection and habitat protection they convey. Lastly, I would just predict that in particular, if the comment period is not extended, I think that the document is probably going to have to be reissued because, you know, there are so many issues with the environmental analysis and the project itself that responding to those comments and putting them into the final EIS-EIR is going to be so different from the draft that the public deserves an opportunity to respond to the changes in the final before it is certified. So I will leave it at that, and I thank you for your time and your patience with us tonight.
Thanks, Dan. Eliza Morris.
Hi, thank you. I actually got to go last time, so if there's other people that want to go before me, I don't know what order. Are you just calling people?
It shows up as an order on my screen.
Okay, that's fine. I'll go ahead. Okay, so I had a few points that came up since last time. First of all, I found a Lower American River Subreach 2 Summary of Bank Protection Conceptual Design Process document for the stuff over by Sac State. It was amazing. It had like stretch by stretch, what the soil type was, what the flow rates in the river, all the details of the technical details that you'd want to look at. I'm hoping that exists for ours and you guys can tell us where to find it. Also, I'm hoping for more information about, I know a lot of people are asking about the trees on the levee and the trees along the edges and what's going to happen to all the trees. But I'm actually concerned about the ones in Larchmont Park. So that's our neighborhood park. And the ones that are over at the top edge of the staging area by the levee, it was unclear if they were marked for removal or what the plan is for those ones, but they're really important to our park. So I wanted to check on those. And also the play structure in the park, I'm sure you guys know, is like really, really close to your staging area. So is there a plan to build a new one further down the park so that people, like kids, can still play? After I told you, I know you probably remember the biking because I bike into work. I actually asked around a little bit and it turns out we have a lot of students living in the area and it's not just me as an employee, but we also have a lot of students who use that bike path to commute as well. So I'm really hoping for some information on what our alternate bike route can look like. And then my final one was, oh yes, I looking through all of your guys' mitigation notes. I noticed that it says that the trucks will always be covered if they're going on major roads. And I wanted to make sure that our roads are considered major roads. And so they will be covered to reduce the dust exposure in our neighborhood. And then also it said that they were going to be hosed down every hour in order to limit the dust. But talking with people over at the Sac State site, it sounds like that did not happen there, and their dust exposure was substantially higher than what the documents indicate they should be. So I just wanted to check, double check on the plans for hosing down everything throughout the process. And that's everything. Thank you.
Thank you. Bill Rattan.
Hi, this is Bill Bratton. I wanted to second the calls for a public meeting, and I wanted to suggest that back in 2004, when the Army Corps heightened the levee and put in a deeper clay core north of, or east of the Mayhew Drain, we had a public meeting at the Earlywine Elementary School, which is right next to the Larchmont Park, and they had a gymnasium there that was plenty big for a whole bunch of people. And I was thinking if we could schedule the meeting earlier in the day, maybe even on a weekend, there would be time to go out and actually walk along the levee next to the Larchmont Park and observe where the trees are, so that Army Corps can tell us which trees they expect would be removed. Because right now we're basically speculating on where these, what trees are being removed. There's all these heritage oaks. Some are fairly close to the levee, some are more distant. But I took measurements of those oaks this morning, the circumference, and one of them was 16.5 feet in diameter, which corresponds with a 315-year-old oak tree. And then the others were up to, well, there was a 250-year-old one and a 275-year-old one. And then down along the shoreline too, it's not clear how far back are the trees going to be removed. And, you know, right now, the way it is, basically, we have to assume all the trees are being removed, all the way from the levee all the way down to the waterline. That's what was done at Sacramento State. And now that's a complete barren moonscape with no trees, no grass. The erosion, I don't know why that's even being called erosion control work, because it's loose soil and the plantings along the shoreline look dead to me. I'm looking at it on my TV screen right now from the newscast today. The CBS News showed Sac State. It's just a complete moonscape. So anyway, once again, I wanted to suggest Earlywine Elementary next to the Larchmont Park, and to combine it with a field trip so we can go out and see, you know, which trees are being removed, because we just don't know.
Thank you, Bill. I'm going to go to Daniel Kay.
Hello, my name's Danny Kay, and I did not speak last time. I'm kind of concerned about the two-legged humans that live around this area. I have a question about, I think it's 3B. I really can't tell by the maps. I live on Waterton Way, and my backyard is butts up against a surge protection from the flood zone or something technical. However, I'm just curious if that is going to be used as a staging zone. Are we going to have heavy equipment just inches away from my back fence? There's about 25 houses. That's my main question. I'm just concerned about me and my neighbors. And thank you for doing all the hard work, everybody, and all our experts on both sides of this. I need all of you, clearly. So thank you. That's it. I look forward to not having tractors in my backyard.
Thanks, Danny. Matt Carr. Matt Carr, are you there?
Sorry, I think I unmute. Try it now, Matt. Matt, I think I unmuted you. Are you speaking? Try it again. How about now? Kelly, can you send him an invite to unmute? Because I can't unmute him.
I'm seeing Matt. It looks like he's already unmuted, or maybe he's on there twice. Let me.
We won't forget you, Matt. It's okay. You can raise your hand. It'll be easier for us to find you in the chat, or I mean, at the participant list where we unmute everyone. So if you can like raise your hand again.
Kelly, why don't you go ahead and answer someone else right now. I'll look at, see if I can unmute him next time.
Okay, the next person is Andrea Wiley. So request has been set and you'll check the box so you can be unmuted. Andrea Wiley, Willie.
Okay, am I unmuted?
I can hear you now.
Hi, well, thank you for the opportunity to speak. I did attend last meeting and I didn't speak that time as I think I will put my comments in writing, but I do want to just speak up and say I'm a native of Sacramento. I'm born and lived here my entire life. I live on the levee on mile 10, which has been identified as the critical zone. And I'm concerned about flood control as much as anyone. I'm also a physician with a long background in veterinary medicine. And I've spent the last 5 months studying the water birds in the habitat along mile 11 north of the American River. And I have witnessed the complete devastation of the water bird and wildlife habitat downstream near the college campus that has completely destroyed the habitat and displaced countless numbers of birds, water birds, and wildlife. The efforts of the Army Corps of Engineers to preserve the riparian habitat has been fully inadequate, and the planned mitigation is in no way adequate. It doesn't provide enough shelter or protection for these animals. The concept of destroying miles of river habitat and replacing it with a single area 2 years later is simply flawed. Further action of the Army Corps in this area would devastate the wildlife and likely be permanent. And simply acknowledging the loss of habitat is not enough. It's like taking all the people in an old neighborhood and putting all the families in a parking lot and expecting them to thrive. I just urge you to suspend this project so that you can create a targeted approach that will not destroy the habitat in this rare and scenic river.
Thank you for your comment. I'll go next to Dom.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, so one of the things that really concerned me was the talk of removing these heritage trees and the increased water temperature. I'm sure you're aware of how dire the salmon fishery is. And so every little bit of habitat matters at this point since it's in such terrible shape. And the idea that where they're rearing their young would have increased temps when we're already looking at increased temps going into the future with climate change. And your own pictures that you showed us of the recovery is like a 15-year timeframe. So what are we supposed to do during that time? And people have already said this, but from Sutter's Landing to CSUS looks terrible. And I get the long-term goal and I appreciate what you're doing for safety in this area, but what about the water temperature for that entire stretch? Is it not gonna be increased? So I'm hoping that that has been studied. And if not, I'd urge you to study the water temperature effect on salmon. And then if you could kind of explain more why you're not doing barges, because the excavators had a huge impact. And then I just want to say that, like, yes, there's these people who live right next to the river, but they're not the only people who are using the American River bike trail, right? I live in Alhambra Triangle, and I use that stretch of the bike trail all the time, and people all over the Sacramento region use this. And then the other thing I wanted to talk about is biking safety. With this bike path, I really hope you're not going to put the alternative path on some public roadway, because the American River bike trail is pretty much the only safe bike path we have in this region. And as mentioned before, a lot of people use that for commuting, myself included. And so shunting people out onto major roadways would not be an adequate solution. And let me look through my list of things I wanted to say. Yeah, and then lastly, I just want to reiterate that I really hope you're effectively reaching out to tribes, and not just tribes that are in this region, but tribes that have a spiritual connection. Thank you for your time and your work.
Thank you, Dom. Nancy Niskern. Nancy Niskern, I sent you the request. I know we heard from you last week.
I know. I'm a slow learner. Thank you very much. I understand the 45-day review period is by law, and it doesn't really get adjusted for the amount of paperwork you're looking at. And I want to be sure everybody knows the volume of what we are supposed to know here. This report that we're looking at is 940 pages. The appendix is 840 pages. That's 1,780 pages. In 45 days, you averaged half to reading 40 technical pages a day. If you take 10 days off, let's say for Christmas and for weekends, that would bring you to 50 pages a day. Now, if you want the history of the project where you have to go to get some of the mitigation, especially for habitat, then you're looking at another report of 459 pages with 13 appendices of 1,962 pages, bringing you to 2,451 pages. Divided by 45 days, that's 53 pages. 53 plus the original 40 is 90 pages a day. I think that's incredible if you expect anybody to even read that. And I'm not talking about understanding it. I'm just talking about plain reading. And I think this is way too short a time. And again, I just want to be like those other people, encouraging, please, to give us an extension, just so we can get through the paperwork. The other thing is, I think it's very difficult for us. We don't have to read every page, but because the projects were all lumped together in one report, it was very hard to sift out what project applies to you and where are those pages that apply to you. So I think next time I would hope that you would have different sections for different projects. It's difficult to understand, and not all acronyms are included in the front, so I'm just guessing at what you mean to say here. One section I look at is the executive summary, page 4. It's talking about the environmental resource categories, transportation, and they talk about trucks, and they talk about, well, this also includes, the first space includes adding 50 or more new truck trips during AM or PM peak hours. And how is that going to be addressed? Some of these acronyms I don't understand, but the CEQA significant conclusion is the same as NEPA. This finding is significant and it's unavoidable. These trucks. Okay, that doesn't answer any questions for me, and I'd like to have some forum to talk about that. To be fair to the public, give us an extension. I already said that. I'm sorry. Please provide meetings. That's been asked for about 5 times. I want to point out that in your appendix, current appendix, there is a portion called chapter 4 calling future public involvement. And it says here, USACE also plans on opportunities for public awareness, involvement, participation, including website updates and formal and informal meetings with interested members of the public, community groups, and individuals as requested. So we are requesting that. Thank you very much. Nature provides a lot of erosion possibilities that we think are going to be ruined because of this construction. But I want to ask for 2 things, and one of those was the extension. The other one is, I would like to invite the core members to the park to look at the parkway and the bicyclists on it, to come with us at any weekend. We set up pop-ups to talk with the public, come with us, learn what these people are saying and what they're concerned about. Also, we have a beautiful aquatic center supported by CSUS north of the Natomas Dam, and they provide all kinds of water sports that they will teach you. Again, we get lessons there, and we come down to the river and we use them: canoeing, kayaking, paddle boarding, sailing. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful event. So we would like to invite people who are not familiar with the river and are part of this project to come and see what it's about person to person. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nancy. I'm going to go to Mikkel Erholt Jensen. We heard from you last week as well.
Yes, hi. So I was here last week. In the meanwhile, I had some time to look through some of the geotechnical reports and some of the information that's out there. And so I want to make a couple of points that I didn't make last time. Based on reading these reports, my impression is that the Project 3B is destructive to the area. It's excessive and disastrously detrimental to the neighborhood. And it doesn't seem in line with recommendations from reports made just a few years previous. In fact, the previous reports and peer reviews offer vastly different measurements that are not as destructive or detrimental to the neighborhood. In the interest of time, I want to just draw attention to one report, the 2017 Lower American River Streambank Erosion Monitoring Report. This report models flows at 145,000 cubic feet a second, which is what they cite as the FEMA base flood flow. And they note that if you look at their panels of the model flow, the flow in the channels in most places is moderate, and certainly near the banks is less than 7 feet per second. They also note that soils with vegetative cover can support 6 to 7 feet per second flow in the mean channel velocity. And they go on to say at the Lower American River, River Mile 9.8, which is right around the area 3B for Project 3B, they say that the planting that they've done there appears to have reduced the rate of erosion, and it has not progressed significantly. On page 10 of that report for River Mile 10.5, which is right around Larchmont Park, I believe, they say the upstream portion of the site has not degraded significantly. And they recommend for erosion control, they recommend cobbles with vegetation or other biotechnical measures. And they do not mention what is currently in Project 3B. So the recommendation in Project 3B is starkly at odds with this previous report just a few years earlier. And I think the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers should really thoroughly address why these measures laid out just a few years earlier are insufficient all of a sudden for this stretch of the river. So I think that needs to be thoroughly addressed. The other point I want to make is that the current Project 3B in its current form does not adequately accommodate recreational use of the river. And again, it goes against previous recommendations, citing again the 2017 report. They say on page 10 of the report, repair of the site will need to integrate recreational use, which is currently not captured in Project 3B. The current project will disrupt the use of the river for 3 years. It will include many more years of regrowing before the river and its vegetation will resemble anything near the usable state for the public. And you can just go and look at the North Bank of Sac State to see what it's going to look like for many seasons to come. And I think the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers needs to address this. This is a significant loss to the neighborhood, and they need to provide adequate alternatives for the duration of the project. And similarly, the final product after those many years needs to be of recreational equivalency to the current river. If you look at the south side, which you stated in your pre-recorded project report, the presentation, that stretch by the Guy West Bridge is now a canal. It does not offer the same equivalency to what our river has. It's artificially straightened. It has no variation in the travel of the edge. There's no still standing water in which you can go in or explore the river. And it doesn't have the same areas for fish to stand in the water. There are not built-in pathways to access the river. The vegetation is ripe with invasive species like star thistle. And it's just not equivalent to what we have here in this area. And it's recreationally more like a canal. And it's not the equivalent of what we have around the Lower American River, River Mile 10. And I think the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers needs to ensure that the recreational use of the river is equivalent both during the project and after. And I would say this should also be brought into commuting, as other people brought up. And finally, I know this has been before too.
You're going a little bit over there. It's okay. Sum it up, please.
Okay. I want to say finally, I think the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers also need to ensure that the project does not negatively impact the health of the community before they proceed with their current destructive plan. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I see Matt Carr has his hand up, so I'm going to try this again. Matt Carr. You've been unmuted. We cannot hear you though. If you're on your phone, what do we have to press, Bailey?
Star 6. And I see Matt, you're on there twice.
Hit star 6. You go. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Wonderful. I'm struggling with my microphone and not on any other platform, so I apologize. Thank you so much to the other commenters. I agree with many of your comments. I'll try to be concise and not repetitive. The thrust of my two main comments are that the aesthetic analysis and the recreational analysis in the SEIS, SEIR is woefully deficient. The most important point that I'd like to make is with regard to riprap. The proposal posits putting miles of rip through the previous commenter of the at the
well, there you are. We missed a sentence or two.
Okay, I apologize. My audio is a nightmare today, no matter how I try it. The recreational analysis in the environmental document says that there will be short-term disruption during construction and staging, but it doesn't mention at all the miles of riprap that are proposed along the river. There is no mention of long-term effects due to losses of beaches, including sandy beaches, coves where people recreate, mature trees, natural riverbanks, and the like. Likewise, there's no alternative to contract 3B that's set forth. It is this way or no way. I'd like to see some alternatives positive that allow us to keep our natural shoreline. The aesthetics analysis likewise says vegetation removal would decrease visual character until plants reestablished. I can't believe that the aesthetics analysis does not mention miles of riprap along the river. If you look at that Sac State stretch, which the Army Corps touts as being beautiful and equivalent and all of that, it's like a canal. There's no natural features along the shoreline. And if you're recreating from the water, it is abhorrent. You merely need to look between the two stretches of contract 3B between Larchmont Park and downstream near Watt. There is a current section that's riprap, and it's a terrible looking section. Nobody recreates there. Everyone recreates upstream or downstream. You are going to turn miles of the river into that. And I don't think that's anything anyone wants. I would also say, echo that, combining all of these disparate projects into one environmental analysis does not allow for any sort of detailed examination. It doesn't allow for alternatives on any of the on contract 3B. I really, really have to ask for better diagrams. It's impossible to evaluate this project meaningfully with the maps and diagrams that are so non-granular. There's no detail, no construction map, no tree inventory. And I've read the appendices. I read all 1600 pages of the document, which I agree is very difficult to read because of the 5 or so projects that are put together in it. But the lack of detail is appalling for a project of the magnitude that it is. Finally, I was the lead. I'm an environmental attorney. I was the lead drafter of an environmental comment letter on the 2016 initial documentation. My most forceful comment is that I'm appalled to see that the 4 pages of that letter, which were signed by nearly every environmental organization in the Sacramento region and beyond, this current supplemental environmental document doesn't discuss it. I mean, the lack of attention to riprap alone is emblematic of the lack of consideration of previous comments made in 2016. I have many other comments. I'll submit them in written form. Thank you so much, and I thank all of the fellow advocates who are here on this call and hope that we can organize to have this project exist because it's probably needed, but it needs to be done with a much, much more nuanced approach. Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. Glad we were able to hear from you. I'll go to the next. David B, gonna send you a request to unmute.
Yeah, I think that's me. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, hi. Hey, yeah, my name's David Ball. I did comment last time, and I don't want to repeat what I said last time. I don't think I could probably say anything with any more detail than already been said by many concerned and intelligent neighbors. I agree with the comments made so far, and I'd just like to add, how concerned I am about the 3B project design. My family really enjoy the natural beauty of the river, as it is. We've been here for 30 years and like it the way it is. And that 3B design, it looks to totally remake our section of river and the trails, not to mention the trails that are down there that we use, into what looks like a man-made riverscape. And lastly, I'd ask that maybe the project timeline be slowed down some, if that's possible. Recommend that more outreach be attempted, because when I talk to my neighbors around here, a lot of them don't even know the project's about to kick off. So that's all I have.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Jamie, I sent you a request.
Yes, thank you. You can hear me?
Yep.
Perfect. I live in the neighborhood of Contract 3B. The river is my backyard, which I use on a regular basis. I second one of the previous speakers also. Those in the neighborhood aren't the only ones that use the parkway, and the public at large should have been notified, not just the neighborhood, on small postcards that were sent out not that long ago. But I did talk a little bit about this last time. I want to, touch on mental health. This is something that is very important to me and many others of all ages, and is not taken into consideration regarding this project. The destruction of the green space on the American River will impact the mental health of those who regularly use the river for a multitude of activities, including but not limited to walking, hiking, running, biking, and meditation. There is extensive empirical literature on the association between exposure to nature and health. Nature exposure improves cognitive function, brain activity, blood pressure, mental health, physical activity, and sleep. Results from a multitude of studies provide evidence of protective effects of exposure to natural environments on mental health outcomes and cognitive function. Research has linked exposure to trees to both physical and mental restoration. For example, a number of studies have found that exposure to urban forests generally reduces mental and physical stress, anxiety, and depression, and that they improve moods. These conclusions of the benefits of mental health through the exposure of green spaces are supported by and cited by the American Psychiatric Association, National Institute of Health, and Yale Climate Connections, just to name a few. Thank you.
Thanks, Jamie. Alicia Eastfold.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. I want to express the importance of your care with this project. This river is a part of the fabric of our community. It's the pride of Sacramento. And when you go to Disneyland and go for a ride on Soaring Over California, it's this river that the world sees. And this project needs more care and buy-in from your community as you go. When it comes down to it, the thing that we are all most expressing our concern and care about is that you can make this project as least impactful as possible, because at the end of the day, when you all go home to your different communities, we're here to live with what you do, and we'll be permanently impacted, not just in the construction time, but possibly for generations to come. So as a community, we're wanting to know that this is handled not with a large pickaxe, but with a scalpel. And from everything that I've been gathering, from the pixelated pictures to the lack of detail on the swath of the river that's going to have trees removed, it's really unclear how you're handling this with the scalpel that this type of work needs. We all want what you're wanting and what your organization helps to do, which is have a safer infrastructure for our community. And I haven't heard one commenter that has disagreed with that goal. I think we all have that in mind, but I have to believe that a group as brilliant as the Army Corps of Engineers, which is doing this work across the United States, not just with the American River, but as I've spoken with friends in Montana, that many communities across the United States are facing these same challenges that we're facing. But I want to believe that your brilliance, which I believe is there, and that you can live up to the ideals that California is all about and preserve the ecology of a place while also developing an infrastructure to keep our home safe. But to do that requires getting into the detail. You're interacting with simple, I feel like a simple-minded neighbor. I don't understand all of the engineering of it, but I do understand the ecology of a place. And I understand that innovation can do two things at once. But that's going to require getting into the detail. And I just want to reiterate why I think that results in needing to have a more in-person detailed report where we can walk the river, see what sorts of possible trees are going to have to go down, what sort of alternatives. We've seen the evidence of what you've done at the Lower Sac State area. And I think our goal is to make sure that that doesn't happen further along, because I know we're all impacted. I'd also like to express, I've lived here since 2021 and I never received any notice of anything in 2022 is what you've shared. I'd like to understand better where the public outreach was being done and how it will continue, because it's been very difficult to understand the scope of this project along the way. Thank you.
Thank you, Alicia. Let's see, I have a guest. So if you've logged on as a guest, I've unmuted you or sent you a request to unmute.
Hello?
Hi. Hi, guest.
Hi, my name's Christy Epperson, and my grandson's okay. House backs up to the construction area that is being discussed. And I'm concerned about his health and well-being, but I'm also concerned about everybody in the community of Sacramento, because as other people have said, the American River Parkway is the jewel of Sacramento. And in, I think it was 1972, the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act was passed that prohibits activities that could damage soil, water, timber, habitat close to the river. It also bars the water board and other state agencies from assisting or licensing facilities that could harm the wild and scenic values of the protected river. And I want to point out what a low percentage of rivers in California are actually designated wild and scenic. So I don't understand how this extensive construction and change in the habitat is allowable. I don't understand how it's been circumvented, because that's what it seems to me. I appreciate your time.
Thank you, Christy. Seems like, okay, next on the list is Brian Whalen.
Hi, good evening. All right, a few comments here. I'll go through them quickly. Public outreach for the proposed work has been insufficient. One postcard being provided with a 45-day opportunity for public comment, 2 weeks of which occur during the holidays, is not sufficient to review and comment on 1,000-page technical documents. Pixelated figures showing unclear information to the affected community is insufficient. I would assume that the Army Corps and its consultants have had years to plan and prepare these evaluations and documents, and it is only fair to provide the affected communities with a commensurate amount of time to respond. Additional outreach is especially warranted considering that the beginning of the second online meeting for opportunity for a public to contribute was botched by technical issues. All the questions being provided by the public during this meeting and the one last week will hopefully be addressed by the Corps of Engineers with opportunity for the community to review and accept those responses. It's fine that meetings have been conducted online via Zoom previously. However, there's been a significant number of people just during this meeting who have requested an in-person public meeting, and I would advocate for the Corps holding a public meeting and not being, for lack of a better word, cowards. A couple of questions. One is, has a cost analysis been performed on how much more it will cost for rock protection to be installed surrounding the existing trees rather than trying to remove them? An appropriate cost analysis would include loss of hundreds of trees, which are hundreds of years old, which are essentially unreplaceable, loss of associated tourism and recreation and commuter aspects associated with those trees, and loss of property value in the, you know, in the affected communities. Another question is, you know, is it correct in reviewing these documents that the nearest levee borehole samples used to characterize the condition of the levee in the area around 3B were collected over a mile away near Howe Avenue, and that there were only 5 samples collected from that area, and that a, you know, decent number of decisions are being made on that data? A significant amount of shoreline geology along section 3B has lots of what the technical documents refer to as a Pleistocene Fair Oaks formation, which is a hardpan clay resistant to erosion. The relevant erosion protection report recommended that the U.S. Army Corps map out those Fair Oaks formations in order to minimize the amount of work that the amount of erosion control work that they would have to be performed. And, you know, it doesn't look like that happened. So my question is, why did the Army Corps not follow through with the recommendations from the erosion protection report? Why were more samples not collected? And why were the areas with the Fair Oaks formation not mapped out sufficiently? As somebody else stated, Contract 3B offers no alternatives. There is just the path offered forward, and you know, typically there is an analysis of alternatives, different methods which may be taken to perform this work and protect public health. That doesn't appear to really have been provided with the 3B analysis. One of the slides I noted, it said that the planning for Contract 4B on the north side of the American River was planned for the future, but that has not been completed yet. My personal take is that that planning and design will never be completed, because that's the side of the river where the residents have money. So surprise, surprise, that 3B is, you know, first in line for all this stuff. And 4B is, you know, just tentative out there in the future. I'm sure those rich neighborhoods will be just lining up to have this work performed in their backyards. And my last question / comment is whether each of the questions typed out in this meeting chat will be transcribed and responded to in a future / final version of the environmental impact report documents. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brian. The only question I can answer is yes, this entire chat will be recorded and transcribed, as well as everything that is verbal. I'll go to C. Duke.
Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
All right. So my name is Clint Duke. I live near the Larchmont Community Park in College Greens East. So basically ground zero for the Corps project 3B South footprint. I fly fish pretty regularly, both in this river and other rivers. So I've kind of viewed these documents, the SEIS and SERIR, through the lens of, you know, salmon and steelhead and half pounder fishing. They're all of particular interest to me, as are their habitats. So in reviewing the documents, I've noticed that Project 3B South is really in direct contrast with some of the American River Parkway plan goals and policies in terms of habitat protection for those salmonids. So think, like I said earlier, Chinook salmon, steelhead, et cetera. So, and you know, the reason this lower American River was granted a wild and scenic status in the first place has a lot to do with those very fish. So, but within the American River Parkway Plan goal policy 3.11 states, and I quote, agencies managing the parkway shall identify, enhance, and protect areas where maintaining riparian vegetation will benefit the aquatic and terrestrial resources and current shaded riverine aquatic habitat. A lot of times that's referred to as SRA, that shaded riverine aquatic habitat. The Central Valley Flood Protection Plan has a very similar statement to this in section 5.27 of their 2016 conservation strategy, listing a need for continuous corridors of riparian vegetation and shady riverine aquatic habitat. That's that SRA popping up again. And in USAIS's own SEIR 4.2.1, it quotes SRA is represented by overhead canopy cover. Overhanging vegetation moderates water temperatures, which is an important factor for various life stages of native fish species. So I basically am quoting all these various policies because it's this canopy in Project 3B South is so important. You know, basically what this boils down to is high water temperatures equal limited migration success for salmonids and limited survival of eggs and their fry, fingerlings, various stages of the life cycle. And moreover, riprapped banks are terrible for habitat complexity and diversity, which are important for survival, growth, migration, reproduction, et cetera. So like the two main aspects of this 3B South project fly completely in the face of recommendations from the American River Parkway Plan, as well as the Central Valley Flood Protection Plan, their conservation strategy. You're removing a canopy of over 500 trees and installing unnecessary riprap revetment as proposed in 3B South will lead to a substantial loss of shade and habitat diversity, which could lower the survival rate of various species of salmonids, among other animals, really. These are just two policies that I found just, you know, scanning through that Project 3B is just bulldozing right over in this quest for erosion potential protection that they really have yet to even show exists in this specific area of the river. So it's very concerning from a recreational standpoint and a conservation standpoint. And I haven't seen a need for it described in the documentation, backed by data. So again, echoing the sentiments of people from earlier, we're really asking for a specific targeted solution, not a one size fits all bulldoze job. It just does not make sense. So.
Thanks, Clint. I'm going to go to the next speaker. I want to make sure that we can get to everyone. So I'm going to try to be a little keeping everyone to 2 minutes. Joe O'Connor.
Yes, I assume you can hear me.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, I'm aware of something called the core standard levy, which has to do with design, among other things, and the trees not being allowed on and near a levee. The Sacramento Area Flood Control Agency put on a few years ago two symposiums where engineers and geologists and so forth came from Europe and all around the United States to a large meeting to discuss flood control, types of soil, and importantly, the advisability or permitting trees on or near a levee. I think if we had in-person meetings, the engineers, the Corps engineers, could kind of explain to the public what constraints they're operating under, and with regards to consideration of the information that came from those two symposiums, one of which I attended. I think it's important for the public to understand, number one, the reasoning behind the Corps' design, and also how much leeway they have with regards to things like trees on and near the levee. That's all I have.
Thank you, Joe. I'll go to Ellen Gantz. Joe, I'm going to mute you. Okay. Okay. Thanks, Joe. Ellen, you're up.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. So at the last meeting, I did speak, and I wanted to have some questions answered because I live on the one of the streets where the trucks will be going by to the park. My street is listed, and I am three houses down from Larchmont Park. That I need to know how much smog and air quality to expect. I need to know if this is safe for my 8-year-old child to live. And it's disheartening to have this be called a public meeting when we're not able to ask questions that are answered by what presumably is a very qualified, knowledgeable group of people back there for someone to just be able to answer questions. And so I would join in the request for meetings where our questions are answered and to have an in-person public meeting. It is the 3B section that I am talking about that everyone else is. I was very curious that Ms. Dewey, you said early on that there would be some new or different information from the questions last week, because I really did want, it's very stressful not knowing what to expect. And I don't see why, if we have this extensive proposal, that these questions can't just be answered in a straightforward way of how many trucks will be down my street every day? Is this going to be on and off? Will it be constant? What hours? What are the toxins that are in the air? Is there any way to measure that and to measure if it gets to unsafe levels? Is there any plan for that? Is there any contact information we can reach out to? The OW Erlewine Elementary School backs up to a construction area. Is it going to be safe for the children in that school? And what mitigation efforts, if any, are going to take place so it can be safe? I really need to know if I should move or relocate temporarily because I don't want to expose my child to harmful chemicals. It's quite scary. And as someone said at the last meeting, we're all reasonable people here who are educated and want protection for the levees and just want to be heard and be included, because as people have said, this is going to be absolutely devastating for our neighborhood, that I chose to live here for this outdoor space, thinking that this would be a place my child can come back to as an adult that's now all being taken away. And if it were the case where I understood that there weren't other options and they were taking into account, I think we'd be a lot more agreeable to that. But just this lack of understanding in this short period of time is disheartening. That I am hoping, as other commenters have stated, that the Army Corps of Engineers, with all this feedback about how important this area is, can take a look at how to use a scalpel rather than an axe, that someone said. Are there ways to minimize the impacts on the recreational use, on the nature, and on the noise and the smog, and keeping this as safe as possible if we're going to be staying in these communities? That I just really ask for any kind of more thoughtful approach and inclusion that is happening right now. That the loss of vegetation and habitat is going to be a strong negative impact on the community in any way this can be offset would just be just needs to be ensured that the U.S. that we're I'm asking that this project does not negatively impact the health of our community, and if there's any way to avoid that, that's what I'm hoping. Thank you.
Thank you, Ellen. Kate Rosenlieb.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
I just want to thank all the other speakers who have already talked and done such an outstanding job. There's not a lot I can add. I too live near 3B South and been here almost 30 years. And it just the level of destruction proposed in this project is mind-boggling to me, and it absolutely will rip the fabric of our community to shreds. And I too want to see a more targeted approach. I'm disappointed at the lack of public outreach. I'm disappointed at the short amount of time to respond to these environmental documents, and certainly the timeline for having them come out just before the major holidays. I'm disappointed when I hear the responses from various officials connected to this project. When we ask about wildlife, well, it'll simply move upstream or downstream. I was here when the slurry wall went in, and you know, a lot of wildlife poured into our neighborhood, and we were left with all this wildlife in our neighborhood. That's not something. There's no mitigation that you're proposing for this, and I'm really disappointed to hear these comments, especially when you show these pictures of the on-site revegetation by Sac State, and gee, you know, it practically looks the same in 10 years, and that's a different type of project. You know, you didn't even show what it looked like before you went in and did the revetment, and a lot of the pictures are at different angles, and the taller trees that you show 15 years later aren't even on the levee or on the riverbank. They're back at behind everything at Sac State itself. And it feels frustrating and disingenuous in that regard. Yes, we all want flood control and appreciate what you're trying to do, but the way this has been rolled out, and you hear how desperate we are to keep this jewel that is absolutely why all of us are living here. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. Julie G.
Hi, thank you for taking my comment. I posted this last time, and you know, I support so many of the comments that have already been made. I don't want to repeat that. But one thing that just keeps stuck in my mind is, particularly for Contract 3B, when reviewing the documents, I saw a section that talked about performance assurances before and after the project. And the areas, particularly in the sites related to Contract 3B, if I'm interpreting the materials correctly, seem to indicate that at best it's going to be a 60% performance assurance in a 200-year flood event, which is what I believe that the project is targeting, is a 200-year flood scenario. Although a lot of the materials do indicate that you want to support further conveyance from the increased storage that's now capable in Folsom Dam. And so I really think that's important, because it's what are we getting for what we're losing? And if you look at assurances for areas downriver, there are areas that are getting higher assurances. And I still am supportive and in the belief that there is a better approach, a much more surgical approach that I think so many people have been asking for. And it is extremely critical that we maintain the canopy and corridors and not create islands of these, because the wildlife that's here that's already threatened or endangered, and those that are just, you know, maybe not on that list, that are struggling to survive, are not going to make it. And the health of our river
isn't attached to our health, from mental well-being to physical health. It's our water supply. You know, a gentleman was talking about the salmon fishery. My husband's an avid fly fisher as well, but from the salmon fishery itself, right now, we're one of the feeder locations, you know, to one of the largest stock areas of salmon. And, you know, they are a 1.4 billion industry that supports an estimated 23,000 jobs. It's closed right now on all the coast and all the rivers because those populations are crashing and in such struggle. And they can't survive if you denude everything along the parkway. Even the fish coming out of the hatchery trying to feed and grow as they move to and migrate from different areas and out into the ocean, they are in need and must have the riparian habitat as well as an appropriate habitat within the riverbed itself. So I just, you know, I think there's a number of issues, but it is really hard to digest, especially to the level of disruption that appears to be coming to us, to see that we're only going to achieve potentially a 60% or a 57% in the other case of one of the sites, where we're at 45 to maybe 47% today without the project. So I think it would be really helpful to have more information on that. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you, Julie. I'm gonna go to Nae, N-A-E.
Yes, hello, thank you for the chance to share, and I really appreciate everyone's amazing insights tonight. It's just so inspiring to hear the knowledge that's coming forth from all my neighbors, and thank you, everybody. So I'm just sharing some concerns. I live near Sacramento State University, and yes, I can attest to the fact that the noise during the project was had a negative impact on my mental health on many days. Building was shaking. Finally, towards the end of the, after most of the shaking was done, they put in the meters to try to measure the vibration. That should have happened before the project started to monitor that. So I have a few requests. First and foremost, stop the project as it currently is without adjustments and without more, as everyone else has said, a more surgical approach, without removing these large trees, and give more time for everyone to read through the documents, understand, ask questions. Also, I concur with the request to have you know, opportunities to actually interact on site with representatives, to be able to have like field days like others have suggested. And another request, at least 1 to 2 months before the project is supposed to begin, please provide a map of the trees that are scheduled for removal on both the north and south sides. You know, the hope is that with these meetings, those trees are not going to be removed because of the canopy that they're providing, the shade that's being provided. And those access points, these are the most highly trafficked access points along the American River Parkway, between the Guy West Bridge and Watt Avenue. And I don't know about the south side because I don't live on the south side, but I know that this whole area is a highly accessed point. I'm concerned about the large mature trees and vegetation between Howe Avenue and Watt Avenue on the north side. It provides a substantial shade protection in the summer, and I can't imagine the increase in heat that the removal of those will provide around the river area. I saw a bobcat in that area this fall. We must present alternatives to these large canopy trees being removed. Even with the watering that happened, there was still layers of dust that got on my car, and you know, in the windowsills. And also, why does the project work east of the J Street Bridge not have any regrowth after 2 years? That was done before the current. So this would have been the work by River Park. And I'm still not seeing grass. It's still brown, and that's after 2 years. That's very concerning. So also the public outreach efforts, I agree with that. I wasn't notified about the work until it already started, and that was last year, and I put in a request to the Army Corps to do better outreach to the public, and apparently that hasn't happened. So a lot of changes, please. Thank you so much for the opportunity, and thank you again, all neighbors.
Thank you, Nay.
Welcome.
If you could write your full name in the chat, that might be helpful. Just as a recommendation for anyone, it's easier to get hold of you if we have your contact information. And you know, it's best to submit via email. That way, we have your email, and we can put you on our list as well. Gonna go to, let's see, Mark Berry.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yep, hi, Mark.
Hi, Kaylee. Thanks for doing this. I'm sure it's not easy. Even though there's some hard things going on. So there's been some comments about the wild and scenic river aspect of the American River Parkway, and people referred to it as a regional asset, but really the American River, the Lower American River, the wild and scenic river aspect of it, it is really the only wild and scenic river flowing through a major metropolitan area in the United States. It's not only a unique regional asset, it's a unique US asset. And, you know, it serves as an example. You know, we're all concerned about climate change or whatever aspect of that, but, you know, it's an example of whether humans and wildlife can actually exist. And it is a wild and scenic river for its outstanding, remarkable values. Two of them, one is its fishery, and the other is its recreational aspects. And really, those unique values, I think you're hearing from the public here, have not been adequately balanced with the project as proposed. You know, we look at the Common Features Project and, you know, been described maybe as a moonscape there, and really the habitats, you know, really been obliterated. But when you look at what the Corps proposed, they did propose very similar kinds of mitigation measures, and there were some, you know, performance standards. But now when we turn around and we look at that, you know, that's really not acceptable to us to continue in our wild and scenic river corridor. And so what we're asking really of the Corps is we're asking for that not to be repeated. We're asking for more creativity and a much more measured response to what is a truly unique American asset, and to treat it like any other river, and to just channelize it, and to get closer to, you know, some of these horribly channelized rivers like the LA River is just not appropriate. The American River Parkway Plan is really the management plan for the wild and scenic river, which the American River is. And that management plan discourages riprap on the river. It does require and want to have shaded areas. And it does have areas designated as protected areas. And when we look at the plan as proposed, although it really is honestly very hard to follow because it's just so generalized, but it doesn't adequately address those protections for the federal and state wild and scenic river that's under the American River Parkway Plan. And I look at the Arusha property, which I guess if you purchased, it's for the set aside property. There's one tree with an eagle's nest. Well, if you're a parkway user, like many of the people here, we see the eagles resting on a lot of the trees now and again. We see all sorts of birds using those trees. And not only are they shades for the fishery and part of the recreational use, but all that's combined with the habitat there. So, I just like to suggest to the Corps of Engineers is don't treat this like just any other place. It really is a unique place. It's a unique American place. There's a goal here, a goal for the future, goal for the future of, you know, can humans really coexist with the environment? And I think what's really need here is the recognition that this is a special project. It really does need some special considerations. And I hope that take that into account. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Gonna go to John.
Hi, yeah, can you hear me?
Yep.
Great, thank you. I'll put my full name in the chat. Thanks for having this meeting. This is the first one I've attended, and you know, other than the postcard I received, this was the first communications I received on it besides what I've seen down at the river itself. I'm located between Howe and Watt on the northern side, and I'm not just, you know, I'm not particularly close to the river. So I second, you know, the idea that this is not just an issue for people who are living right along the river. I also voice consideration and understanding that you know, we do need to be mindful of flooding. But I think all the comments that we're hearing and today, I don't think we've heard someone say, go ahead with this project. We love it. It's great. That may not be, that's probably not typical for these kinds of meetings where someone comes and says, I really wholeheartedly support it. But you're really hearing from a lot of people here who are opposed to it. And I think what it comes down to is, do we trust the process that has been laid out for us? Do we trust that this item, this thing that's important to our neighborhoods and our communities, might, you know, and for transportation, my kids take the trail to get to school because they don't want to ride on the roads to be, because so they won't be exposed to cars. So it's, you know, there's the transportation thing. I'd also like to second or third the part about mental health. Here we are on the back end of the pandemic, where so many people found solace and recharge in the outdoors, and now you're going to be taking away that value from them in this place, and that's a big deal. You know, I've witnessed wildlife along there. I've seen species that aren't listed. You know, I found a rubber boa down there one time. I've seen all the snakes. I've seen otters. I've heard, you know, I've seen a sea lion in there between that area. So this is an important area for wildlife, in an area that I use often and my family does. And to me, the trust issue is important, because I've spent a lot of time down by River Park. And if it's going to look like that, I don't see how that helps. I'm sorry that those things are auto-generated on my.
That was fun.
Yeah, WebEx. Here you go. I don't see how that improves the situation. Removing vegetation to help surge is counter to every sort of river things about rivers I've ever heard. Second, you know, there's this issue of, you know, I'm just looking at some of the documents, and one of the things that it mentions yellow-billed cuckoos, and it's not yellow-billed cuckoos, it's yellow-billed magpies. And that's an endangered species. That would seem like something that people would pay attention to. It is important. And so I'm having trouble trusting what's going on, and I just don't see how that kind of project and what I've seen along the way is going to improve things. We just had one of the biggest water years in history along this area, and despite a little bit of flooding underneath the Watt bridge along the path, in this area there wasn't that much flooding. And I realize it's an erosion project, but it's related to flooding. And so if there weren't huge negative consequences in this area during last year, and I went down to Glen Hall Park, I don't see how that's going to help. And someone mentioned, does the long-term benefit of removing this worth the short-term pain? And I don't see it. And so I'm very concerned about this project, about something that I use practically every day, people in my family use every day. And I don't have that level of trust with the way things, I look down the river and it's the riprap and a channelization. I'm a fly fisherman too. I don't see it. So I offer that respectfully and I appreciate your time.
Thank you, John. Mara?
She basically.
Mara, are you there?
Am I here?
I hear you. Yep.
Okay. Hello.
Hi.
This is my first time attending. So I've been keeping up with everything, but I haven't like physically been in a meeting. But I just wanted to add like my two questions. When I was in school, I went to RISD and studied architecture and graphic design. And I was just curious, like, if there was an environmental designer or an environmental graphic designer even working on the project. Because for me, if I were to submit a proposal or a project like this to my professor, I would fail. Because in any profession of that regard, like, the main purpose of that is to create functional design that supplements, you know, the environment. You know what I mean? So with most eco designers, they'd be appalled at a project of this magnitude because they aim to create spaces that are both functional and aesthetically pleasing, that promote a sustainable relationship between people and the environment. And so most designers, environmental architects, or regular architects, you know, who are supposed to cultivate, create environments that are stimulating, normally focus on green spaces and preserve a lot of the green spaces and topography that balance with the climate. The core of this project, from what I've seen in the other, you know, places where it's been done, is ugly. Like, no, in my opinion, and like most of my classmates, any of my professors would agree with me, a pile of dirt that's very poorly executed is not attractive. So is there anybody in charge of those things? Like, is there anyone even, you know, helping with that, or like is there any of that? Because from my perspective, it doesn't seem like there is, you know what I mean? And if so, like, where did they get their credentials from? You know what I mean? Like, it's very absurd in my opinion. And then my other question is just, if this has a projected time period of like, you know, 15 years or whatever, it's going to be so beneficial, why not wait to have physical data of this benefit instead of ballparking, oh, maybe this will happen or maybe it won't, just having like evidence, physical evidence, instead of just a projected projection. So those are just my two little things to say. And I really, like, when I tell you it's ugly, it's just ugly. Like, it's dirt and sand in piles with little sticks that have like twine that are, you know, where the plants are going to grow back that they took out, which is redundant, I think, when you already have natural trees and plants that are already there, to remove the ones that are there, to put in ones that are, you know, like not growing yet, and haven't grown in some areas still. Like, what I learned in school, that's something that you would absolutely not do. That's very bad. So that's just kind of my question. When it comes to all of that, you know, in my little area of study, I just really am confused. And, you know.
Thanks, Mara.
Yeah.
Appreciate your comments. I'm going to go to Gay Jones. And we are almost at 8 o'clock. I know we started a little late, so I see a few more hands up. So we're going to try to get to everyone. I just wanted to let everyone know it's about 5 minutes to 8.
Okay. Hey, Kayla. Good evening. Sorry you got the short straw on this one, but here goes. I have multiple points to make. I've lived in this area since 1987 by the Grismo Recreation Area of the Parkway. Given all the concerns and questions raised about data and outreach, the Corps needs to pause. The Corps needs to pause on any new work. Given all these questions about data, let's see how the project work that has already been done will perform under real life events. Is there any real life example anywhere where this type of project was successful? Another point, concern about proposed mitigation. Past experience, given the lack of sustained attention at Gristmill, as well as a revetment area by Sarah Park behind Bill Griffith's old house, does not lend a high degree of confidence in any sustained mitigation reparation project. Another point, the existing islands upstream from Howe and Watt Avenues have a role in slowing down flows. Where is this discussed in the Corps' report? For example, the barrier islands off the east coast of the US have displayed effective impacts on reducing shoreline erosion. Appears it's very similar here. Last point, at the very least, a significant extension of the comment period is needed. Thank you. Contact me for any questions.
Thank you, Gay. I'm going to go to Elton Grau. Or Grew, G-R-A-U.
Or Ms. Dewey, can you hear me?
I can hear you now. Speak a little louder though, please.
No problem. Hi there, I'm Elton Grau. I live right off the American River. Two thoughts. Thought number one is, Ms. Dewey, you've been great the last two hearings or meetings that we had. And one of the things I've enjoyed is the fact that on your video, you have this beautiful woodland right behind you, right? And what was interesting, and I find it kind of more like satirical maybe, that's the background all of us have on the American River, right? We have this beautiful forest behind there that we can walk, we can jog, we can run, we can have a breakdown at times and have conversations with our partners. We can enjoy this nature. And what the Corps is trying to do right now is to eradicate that nature, destroy those trees for a project that we're all kind of going, is it necessary to do all those things at such a level where we are changing the habitat? We are changing the fundamental look of that American River in this location. And I hate talking about my job, but the second point that I wanted to make is a more important point, which is due process. I'm a prosecutor at San Juan Key County. And before I can prosecute somebody, we can punish someone, they have a right to see the evidence that people have, to look at that evidence, to question that evidence, to study that evidence, and to question me. And the one thing the Corps hasn't done is this ability to give us this 900-page report within the last, maybe month or so. And all of us are going through it. And let me say this, it is a miracle that we have engineers, that we have biologists, that we have therapists, that we have people who have looked at this project and kind of analyzed it, because in reality, we're being forced to look at this project and accept it. And it doesn't work. You know, when you look at it, when you analyze it, when you look at what they're claiming, I don't think it's there. And that's why when I bring back the idea of due process is, we have need an ability to speak to these engineers, to speak with these various people that will find, hey, it's necessary to do something like this. And now I'm not saying, because I'm not a scientist, I'm not an engineer, I'm a dude that goes up to the courts and I make an argument. And the argument that I think that's necessary right now to make is this simple point. We don't have due process. We haven't had an ability to analyze this project and actually say, is it necessary? And in the conclusions that the Corps has made, they're not backed by the science that we are bringing into this analysis. And with that, I'm going to close with this really simple point. Everybody who's been on this the last two nights have been incredible. They've showed passion, they showed knowledge, they showed an understanding of the science. And what the Corps is about to do is eradicate the natural habitat of birds, coyotes, of deers, of turtles, water birds, flying birds, you name it, it's changing. The skunk, the raccoons, it's all gonna change for them. And all because of an idea of erosion control that none of us really kind of appreciate and understand, and that the Corps isn't even willing to sit down and have a conversation with us. And with that, I kind of rest.
Thank you, Elton. Let's see. Carrie Necht. Oh, I'm sorry, you had already unmuted and I muted you again. Sorry, Carrie.
Hi, can you hear me, please?
Yeah.
Okay, good evening. Well, thank you for staying late with all of us. I'm very glad at the outset you mentioned that there were members of the SAFCA board here, and I really appreciate that, and also would like to echo the suggestion made early on that we do have an in-person meeting, one that involves SAFCA, the, you know, all of the decision makers here, because I think it's really important to have this conversation with folks who are local and who really understand the value of this river and how it stretches far beyond, you know, those of us who live in the neighborhood. I spoke last time about how I see so many families out there swimming, rafting, fishing, and, you know, we walk the stretch as well, my son and I, and I have to say we studiously avoid the section with riprap. We go up and around it because it's just so unpleasant on that part. So I would suggest and request that you hold that public workshop, not just with staff, but with board members and in advance that there be broader outreach. I would really like to see posters up at Larchmont Park for all the soccer families that come out there. I'd like to see posters at all the entrances to the parkway. There's so many places where those who didn't get postcards may not know how their lives are about to be impacted for years or decades to come. You could also do TV news outreach. I mean, the Pest Control District regularly gets media coverage for their mosquito updates, so I'm sure this plan would be something the media would be really interested in. I personally look forward to reading those thousands of pages and hope that you provide an extension because, you know, I'd really like to learn more about the air toxins. I'm concerned because I have one child at OW Earlywine and another child who's too young but will be entering kindergarten. And I go there regularly at lunchtime and I see every day there's hundreds of children out there. And I hope you can, as I talk, you can think of your children, your grandchildren, maybe yourself at ages 5 and 6 when you're in the playground and think about, you know, from the flagpole of OW Earlywine, you know, in my younger years, I probably could have thrown a softball and hit this area where you're proposing to have all of this extensive equipment staging. So I think it's going to have an enormous impact on the neighborhood and on all of those children. And I'm really interested and concerned to learn more about what all of those health repercussions could be for those little bodies running around the playground. They have a jogathon and you just see them panting. And it really concerns me to think about what they could be breathing in and the long-term impacts that could have on their health. So thank you for your time this evening, and I look forward to learning more.
Thank you, Carrie. So I see another hand has been raised. I know people are trying to get their final comments in. I ask that we don't have any new hands raised. I see the people you've already commented. I've already heard from you, but I would like to hear your final remarks. So go ahead, Pete Spaulding.
Okay, I thought I was going to go last, but that's okay. Kaylee, I just hope some of the project leadership are on the line tonight or they'll listen to this, because this is not a not in my backyard problem. The parkway is a regional park. It has more visitors per year than Yosemite National Park. What's being done to the parkway is a direct violation of the American River Parkway Plan. And there have been representatives on the call tonight from Supervisor Desmond's office and from the American River Parkway Association. And I hope they report back to them because it's in our backyard, it's in my backyard, but this is not in my backyard problem. This is a regional problem. And as Mark Berry pointed out, we're one of the few urban areas in the country that has a wild and scenic river that runs right through the middle of the city. So something like this that goes out and asks for public input of a project of this magnitude is ridiculous. So I just hope that your leadership will listen to this. Listen to us. We can have an open public meeting at OW Earlywine School right next door and let them listen to what's going on. And when all this is over, I promise I'm going to buy you a bottle of wine. I'm done.
Thanks, Pete. Lisa Merritt.
Good evening, everybody. So I made a beeline to get back here from clinic and the hospital, and thank you very much for giving us this time, because we need some kind of process. There are significant mental health ramifications of just the anticipatory anxiety of what our community has been thrown into, and that should be recognized. This is a public process, and I agree with the attorney. Thank you for the due process. So I specialize in catastrophic care. This situation reminds me from a medical standpoint, the importance of properly prehabbing and evaluating and coordinating care and communicating to achieve optimal outcomes and satisfaction. If I have a diabetic patient, like I have several that have amputations, et cetera, but you know, maybe they had an infection, you try to work together with vascular, you get the testing, the labs, et cetera. You try to save the limb, sometimes you can't. But that's only after you fully evaluate everything, unless you have an emergency situation, and then you do the best you can, and then you try to put them back together as best you can. You know, same thing with brain surgery or anything else. But this project, if you were to take it as a medical analogy, would be considered a significant, this is malpractice. This is not based on, you know, the proper evaluation, the proper data. All of a sudden we're in a rush. There's no threat. There's no immediate threat. We've already withstood high levels of water here. It's like amputating, you know, dense, long established vegetation in exchange for loose, sandy soil. Based on a confounding pre-assessment, it's like not even properly examining the patient beforehand, saying, well, I think we should just cut this out. It'll be better like this. You know, that's very, very not what we'd like to see happen in something of this magnitude of what's at stake here. This is significant. If it was a doctor approaching this, you know, we lose our license. I'm licensed in 8 states. I worked across this pandemic, across this whole thing on the front lines, and we had to work together. We had to work hard and fast and save people. And it was tough, but we did that because we pulled together and we used the available information, we exchanged it and worked on it across the world as best we could. The Army Corps of Engineers has been given lots of information, has been faced in this conversation before, and it's a power and a money issue, and we should just put that out in the open. What does it take to redirect this so you can continue to get the funding that wants to be secured for this, and at the same time feel authoritative by really turning to your own data and using it properly? You know, I mean, there's things like when was the last time that there was any overtopping? I don't think ever in this area. When you look at the velocity flow measures and things, it's like, if I were to have the vascular surgeon show that there's good blood supply, would I tell him to go ahead and cut the leg off? No. We rehab the person. Maybe we have to cut a couple toes, but we'd rehab that leg, okay? And when we look at this, we know that there have been scientific reports showing that vegetation helps. Why are we having this contradiction in terms on saying that vegetation is a risk? What's this about? I really am concerned. And we know the water temperature is a real issue, and we're going to deny this, and climate change and air quality issues. And, you know, I have a daughter who you heard speak quite eloquently, who has health issues. People in my neighborhood have health issues. We have young children at that school that was raised earlier. They're just supposed to be collateral damage for this wonderful, noble project that's not even indicated. Again, that's malpractice, public health malpractice. So I really want to understand this, and I want to know, why are they hiding then? Why are they putting you guys up in front? If it's with such confidence and such swagger, then come on out and tell us then. Explain this to me. Okay? That's what I want to really know. As a clinician, I stand by what I say. When I assess something, I sit and talk with people until we're all on the same level of understanding. That's first, do no harm. That's the standard we're held to. Engineers, my father was an engineer. He raised me well, and that's why over 3.5 decades ago, I assessed this area and I knew it to be safe, and I chose this home. And it has been, and it's a beautiful community. We have a blue zone here, a balanced community, and there's a lot of love in this room, and that's why there's so much concern. Because we understand what we experienced, the magic here, and we don't want it to get destroyed, especially not for justifiable reason. So no unnecessary surgery, thank you. But I love the analogy of the surgical approach. So let's try to be targeted. Let's go back to the barges. Let's go back to the drawing board together. And let's come on over and visit. You're going to really like it here. You'll like us. We're really nice. Thank you.
Thanks. I have one more hand up, Brenda Gustin.
For a couple of years, I've been doing my best, and so have some others, to talk with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers about the floodway upriver. And the thing that I don't understand that people do here is we district ourselves and we segment, and we have a reductionist model that we're working with here. And yet a river is contiguous. It runs. And all of the animals that live alongside it and live in the river, they don't see districts separating us. So I haven't understood why the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, Central Valley Flood Protection Agency, SAFCA, DWR, all of us aren't working together with the community. And why is it that the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers couldn't or wouldn't weigh in on a floodway just upriver and protect it? That is the Central Valley Flood Protection Agency's designated floodway, where nature has already carved out an area to take this excess flow. And instead, you know, people were, you know, considering the idea of building and filling in a floodway because that's something we've done in the past. But to do things that we've done in the past that we know are not wise doesn't make any sense. And why don't we take a look at this from a community standpoint all together and see what nature's already created to help us to stay out of harm's way when the water starts to rise. So I'll stop there, but it seems to me that we could all work together. And I was very disappointed to hear tonight that they don't even have a way in to extend the public comment past tonight or past the February 5th. I think that's very short-sighted. Thank you very much, though, for what you're doing to facilitate tonight. And I do hope that we will be able to have a public meeting in person. Thank you.
Thanks, Brenda. So that wraps up the public participation portion of the evening. I really appreciate all of you being here. All of these words are not lost. They're not just in one ear, out the other. We do have leadership on the meeting. We do have members of all of the project proponents on the meeting. It's not just the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. It's not just federal, it's local, it's state. All the agencies are here listening to these concerns. And we hope that this is just the start of our public outreach. You know, there's a lot more that we realize can be done. We do see like your emails in the chat and your full names in the chat. If you email us with your written comments, we'll have a better record of your email so that you can be put on any notification lists in the future. We have been putting the emails in the chat so that you can email us directly. We see those every day coming in. Like I said at the beginning, but I'll say it again in case you missed the portion, we have been receiving a lot of comments regarding extension of the public comment period. A decision has not yet been made, but it is, it has to go up through the chain, and it has to be, you know, it's not just I can decide tonight. All of these comments, you know, are being considered and will, you know, make a stronger argument, of course, for leadership to make that decision. So once that's decided, I was told this morning that that we hope to have an answer next week that will be posted on SAC levy upgrades if that extension is granted, and how many days that would include, and you know, if a new end date for accepting comments would be included with that. And then everyone who has asked for an extension would be notified via email as we've received them already. So I think that wraps it up for me. Once again, all of these comments will be included in a final document And they will have responses from our huge interdisciplinary team, not just myself. I'm a biologist by education, but they will be directed to our subject matter experts, like our hydraulic engineers. Maybe you have a civil engineering question, the people who deal with erosion protection measures and why is this the best for this area. You will have answers for your comment. I'm sorry that we can't get you those answers tonight, but you will get those answers and you will see them in writing and they'll be long, and everyone will get the answer they deserve. But I'm sorry that we couldn't give them to you tonight. I think that's all that I have. I really appreciate everyone. Everyone just spoke beautifully. Everyone had so many important comments. You really pulled on my heartstrings. So thank you very much for your time. I put any last comments in the chat. We'll leave it open for a few more minutes. Thank you for attending, and I hope you have a great evening.